Today, right now, for the next hour or so, Amal Roy and myself, we will try to explain to you how the Nash theorem is proven. We'll just give you a rough basic idea of the proof. I am Mayank Ratan Bharadwaj. This is Amal Roy. We are both from the game theory lab at IISc. So I'll give you a quick run through, and then I'll try to prove the Sperner's lemma. Then Amal will come up and he'll use the Brouwer's theorem to prove the Nash theorem. After that, we'll have the tutorial session with Anand, Shridurga, Amal and myself. So before we start with the Sperner's lemma, let's just have a quick recap, just some basic mathematical definitions. You all remember what a function is. You might also recall what a correspondence is. In case somebody's forgotten, just a quick recap. A correspondence from set X to set Y will take a value in X and give you a subset of Y. Right? Similarly, we can define the graph of the correspondence. If we take all such values X, Y, we get the graph of the correspondence. And this will be a closed graph if Xm goes to X in X and Ym goes to Y, such that Y belongs to Fx. All right? Let's go through what upper hemicontinuity is. Say we have sets X and R in R power n and R power k. Then we'll say that a correspondence going from X to Y is upper hemicontinuous if it has a closed graph and the images of compact sets are bounded. In a way, we are trying to get something like you have continuity in functions. So upper hemicontinuity will be used for correspondences in a similar fashion. Let's come to the main point, fixed points. As I said, Amal will use the Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Sometimes people use the Kakutani's fixed point theorems. Generally, fixed point theorems are used to prove results such as the Nash theorem. So what is a fixed point exactly? A fixed point is if I enter a value in a function, if it ends up giving me the same value, so you enter X and you end up with X, then it's a fixed point. Simple example, the value 0 and 1, if you take x square, f of 0 is 0, f of 1 is 1, so they are both fixed points. Similarly, you can define something for a correspondence as well. If you enter the value x, and the value that it gives fx, if x lies within that value, then that's a fixed point of the correspondence. So it's something similar to the fixed point of a function. It's just that whatever value you had entered, is it there in the result or not? So I'll just go through this quickly because Amal will cover this properly. Brouwer's fixed point theorem says that given the function f going from x to x, which if it is continuous, then it needs to have a fixed point. It's a very strong theorem, and Kakutani's fixed point theorem in 41, Kakutani kind of extended the same thing to correspondences. He says that given a correspondence going from x to x, if it is upper hemicontinuous, then it should have a fixed point, given, of course, that it is non-empty and convex and compact. Here, I'm not giving you a proper proof. I'm just giving you a very rough outline of how some people go about it. You have already seen that PSNE looks something like this. You can take the best response strategy that a player I can play against all the other players. So if all the other players are playing S star minus I, the best response would be for a player I to play S star I, and which can also be written like this. And then you can define a correspondence so, and then you can say that, if I have a fixed point in this correspondence, it's as good as having a Nash equilibrium. So if you don't understand this, no problem. Amal will do it in a much better fashion. Similarly, for MSNE also, we can apply a similar approach. So let's come to Sperner's lemma. Let's come to the main point of this talk, why I'm here. I'll try to prove the Sperner's lemma, after which Amal will take over. Before we start Sperner's lemma, let us start with triangulation. We have a triangle ABC. Now, you take the midpoints of each of the edges and you connect the midpoints. Say the midpoints are X, Y, Z. Once you connect ABC, all the midpoints of ABC, you get four smaller triangles. AXY, XBZ, ZCY, and XYZ. Go on in the same way. Now take these four triangles, find their midpoints, connect them. From 4, now we go to 16. From 16, we go to 64, 256, and so on. Now, you can take any stage of this triangulation. Let's take this triangulation at any given stage, and let us try to label the vertices of the triangle. How shall we label the vertices? If I'll take the outer edge, this outer edge, any vertex lying on this outer edge cannot be labeled A. Any vertex lying on this outer edge cannot be labeled the same as the opposite vertex C. And any vertex on this outer edge cannot be labeled B. So those basically are your first three rules. And the fourth rule is very simple. It's like, okay, you take any internal vertex and you label it the way you want. This is just one random labeling that we have done. You can do any other labeling as long as it follows the four rules. After labeling, let us try to shape the triangle in such a way that first we find out all the smaller triangles. Let's call these baby triangles for the ease of convenience. Let's call these smaller triangles as baby triangles. And let's find all the baby triangles which have all the three vertices A, B, and C. So this will not qualify because it does not have C. This will qualify because it has all A, B, and C. So let's take all baby triangles which have all three vertices A, B, and C and let us shade them. And while we are shading them, let us shade them in two different ways. If I go A, B, and C clockwise, I will shade them in one way. If I go A, B, and C counterclockwise, I will shade them in another way. So this will be shaded, say, in lines, and this will get a dark shade. So let's shade them in this manner. All right, so far so good. So we have a triangle, we have triangulated it, we have smaller triangles. You can go further and further and further ahead. And my claim to you is that you can label all the vertices of the triangle in this fashion. Agree? Disagree? Sorry, what is random? A, B, and C on the sides. It's all random. The only rule you have to follow is if it is opposite to C, then there is no C here. And the bottom edge is opposite to A, so there is no A here. And this edge, there will be no B. That's the only rule. Other than that, it's all random. You can go for one labeling, I can go for another labeling, and Sperner's lemma will still hold for both. Sorry? Yeah, so do you agree that I can take any triangle, triangulate it in this manner, maybe n iterations, n can be any number, you can go on doing it, and afterwards you can take all the baby triangles and you can give them such a labeling, A, B, and C, according to those four rules. Do you agree with that? It is possible for all triangles? It is possible. We'll come to that. We'll come to that. So this is for the proof. It'll help you with the proof. And after you have labeled it in that fashion, you'll take the triangles with A, B, and C, and if it is clockwise, then you'll shade it with lines, and if it is anti-clockwise, you'll just do a dark shade. Agree? That also is possible. Yeah. We are trying to prove the Sperner's lemma, and I thought it'll be good if I just gave you an aha moment, but in case you don't want that, the Sperner's lemma tells you, we only need a part of the Sperner's lemma, which tells you that there is at least one triangle ABC. So it says if you go on triangulating like this to infinity, there will still be one triangle ABC in this. It will not be like all triangles have same vertices. But if I told you that up ahead, I'm sure you would fight with me, so I didn't tell you before. Right? So I'm slowly breaking it to you. Of course, it's a bit stronger than that, and I'll state it now. But that is all we need, that there is one triangle ABC. But let's try to prove something stronger. Why not? So, as you can see, clockwise I have two triangles in this example, and anti-clockwise I have three. Let us denote it by NC and N of AC. NC would be the number of triangles which are clockwise and number of triangles which are anti-clockwise. And as far as these unshaded triangles are concerned, we haven't shaded them because we just don't care how many are there. All right, let there be any number. I am only concerned about these two numbers here, right? And here's the, they shouldn't say theorem, they should say lemma actually, it's a lemma. So this is the lemma. This is what we'll try to prove, that NAC is equal to 1 plus NC. Again, there are different versions of the lemma. The most popular version is the two-dimensional version, which I'm talking to you about now. Towards the end, we'll talk about the multidimensional and one-dimensional as well. So this is the two-dimensional version. It says number of anti-clockwise triangles is 1 greater than the number of clockwise triangles. And naturally, a simple implication from that is that the total number of triangles is always odd and always greater than 0. And that is all Amal will need. He'll only need that there is one triangle that exists. Okay? But since we can prove something harder, let's try and do that. Why not? Okay. So let us try to label the edges in this fashion. And please let me know if you disagree with me at any point, if you think any of these cannot be done. We'll go to the board and we'll try to do it. So what I'm doing is, if any edge has the same label, say A and A or B, then I'll give it a value 0. If it has different labels and they appear in a counterclockwise fashion, I'll give it a value 1. If it is the other way around, I'll give it a value minus 1. Now here I'm expecting a doubt that if it's an internal edge, then it will be both clockwise and anti-clockwise, right? So let's take this edge AB. Now, in one triangle it is clockwise, in the other it is anti-clockwise. So will you give it plus 1 or minus 1? So my answer to you is, we'll give it both the values, plus 1 for one triangle and minus 1 for the other triangle. Let it have both the values for now. Then what I'll ask you to do is add all the values. You add both the values that you gave to the edge, and that will give you the Sperner number of the edge. If the edge is on the towards the very end, then it has only one value going from B to C, then that is the Sperner number of the edge. Yes. ABB. So are we talking, which edge are we talking about, AB or BB? This edge is clearly 0, right? Now let's talk about this edge. So say we are going AB like this. So if it's clockwise, it's minus 1. If it's counterclockwise, it's plus 1, right? So ABC is what we'll follow always. So A to B, we are going like this, which is counterclockwise. And here, A to B, we are going like this, which is clockwise. Okay. And there's no significance between plus 1 for counterclockwise and minus 1 for anti-clockwise. You can also swap the two. You can give it plus or minus n. The proof still works. Yes, please. Yes. Yeah. How is it? No, so we are labeling edges right now. What do you mean, how is A labeled? How is this vertex labeled? This vertex is labeled as A. No, your question is, what is the number? Yes, it's random. Purely random, no rules whatsoever. Yes, your choice. Yes, entirely your choice. Even in the external edges, whether you want to give this A or B is up to you. Just not C. My only compulsion is not C. That's it. All right? So far, so good. Now, let us take each baby triangle. Let us take all the three edges of the baby triangle and add them up. All right? Once you add them up, the number that you get is the Sperner's number of the baby triangle. Now, I hope you understood what Sperner number of an edge is and what the Sperner number of the baby triangle is, because that is what I'll use to prove my lemma. This is what it looks like. So these unshaded triangles that we were not interested in at all, they'll all end up having the number 0. And the shaded triangles will either have plus 3 or minus 3. I hope... Yes? Why do we say that? So, okay, please ignore these two lines. They shouldn't have come here. They've come by mistake. So what we are saying is take any baby triangle, and that baby triangle will fall under one of the four categories. So either the three vertices are different and labeled counterclockwise, or they are labeled clockwise. So if they are counterclockwise, then or clockwise, all the three edges have the same value. So the Sperner number of the triangle ends up being plus 3 or minus 3. Let's say that's not the case. Let's say two of the vertices are same and one is different. Something like this. So then what you see is between the two same vertices, the Sperner number of the edge will become 0. The labeling of the edge will become 0. And with these two, they will definitely have opposite labelings. One will be plus 1 and the other will be minus 1. So again, the Sperner number of the triangle will end up to be 0. And the third case is if all the three vertices are the same. Sorry, the fourth case is if all the three vertices are the same, then naturally all the edges are 0. So the triangle also ends up getting a value of 0. So we have, like this figure shows, you either end up with a plus 3 or a minus 3 or all zeros. And clearly zeros are the ones which are unshaded, which do not have all three vertices ABC. And plus 3 are the ones which go anticlockwise, and minus 3 are the triangles which go clockwise. Good. So if you guys are with me so far, then we'll move on with the proof. Take any edge. Its value, if it is an internal edge, is going to be either 0 or 0. So it's either 0 plus 0 or 1 plus minus 1. You end up getting a 0. All the external edges will end up having a value 1. The sum of all the edges on the external edge will end up having a value 1. Do we see why that is? So I'm starting from A. Let's take this edge. I'm starting from A. Now an edge can either be A or B. So if I'm going from A to A, I'm going to get a value of 0. A to B will give me plus 1, B to A will give me minus 1. But when I go this way, finally I start from A and I end up at B. So in all, my sum total is going to be plus 1. Similarly, when I start from B and end up at C, my sum total is going to be plus 1. And when I go from C to A, again my sum total is going to be plus 1. So if I was to add all these up, I'll end up with 1 plus 1 plus 1. So 3 will be my sum on the external edges, and all the internal edges will anyway be 0. So my total sum will end up being 3. So the sum of all the Sperner edges, sum of all the Sperner numbers along all the baby edges is 3. Any guesses what the sum would be for all the baby triangles? Yes. Oh. So it has to be the same as the edges, right? Because how do I get this Sperner number of a triangle? It's the sum of its labels of all its edges. And the sum of all the Sperner numbers is the sum of all the labels of the edges. So the sum of all the Sperner numbers of the triangles will also be the same as the sum of the Sperner numbers of the edges. Two verbose? Was I too verbose, or does any of it make sense? Not much, okay. So let's take the second thing. Sum of Sperner numbers of all the edges. How do I get these? Add all the Sperner numbers. But each Sperner number is what? The sum of the labels? The sum of all the labels of the edge. An edge can have one or two labels. I'm adding all the labels and I'm getting the sum of all the labels. That is the same as the second line here. The sum of all the labels of the edges is the same as the sum of all the Sperner numbers of the edges. Agree? Now let's take the first line. How do you get this? Take the label of the edge, one particular label of the edge with respect to this triangle, right? Take it for all the three edges and add it. But each edge will contribute to two triangles. So it will end up contributing both its labels to one or the other triangle. No label will be contributed twice. So at the end, when I sum all these up, it will be the same as these. Agree? And like we've already seen, this sum is 3. So this also has to be 3. Agree? Now we've seen that the sum of unshaded triangles is 0. And the shaded triangles are either plus 3 or minus 3, depending on whether or not they are clockwise or anti-clockwise. So the sum of this, this, and this has to be 3, which means this is the equation I get. I simplify this, and this is what I get. So this is the Sperner's lemma, the two-dimensional version. This is the simple proof. Any doubts, or do we move ahead? Good. So we've proven the Sperner's lemma. There's also the one-dimensional case, which is not very difficult to see. I mean, you just you're going from 0 to 1, and you keep switching between 0 and 1, and the number of switches that you make is going to be odd. This number of anti-clockwise, number of clockwise. So this, sorry, where is this? Yeah, so NC is the number of clockwise triangles and NAC is anti-clockwise. What do you not get? How do I come? From the Sperner number to the number of triangles. Okay, let's do that again. So, sorry, you are with me till here, right? And this is the doubt, or you're all right. Okay, you're with me till here. And how do I come here? So, okay, you don't get how I got this. So here I'm saying that the sum of Sperner numbers of all baby triangles is 3. Let's go back to my favorite slide. And if I add up all the Sperner numbers, the unshaded triangles are all giving me 0, so I can happily ignore them. The NAC and the NC are contributing either 3 or minus 3, so the number of triangles into 3 or number of triangles into minus 3, which is what we did here. Oops, which is what we did here. NAC into 3 and NC into minus 3. And like we said, that sum is equal to 3. So we added that and we equated it to 3. All right. So one-dimensional case is very simple. Two-dimensional case is what we just saw. And this is also generalized to the n-dimensional case. We'll not go through the proof of that here. But just to give you a basic idea, what we are doing is we are using an n-dimensional simplex. So instead of 2D, we are using an n dimensions. And instead of labeling them A, B, and C, we are labeling them as A1, A2, on up to AN plus 1. Even then the result will hold. And even in n dimensions, we know that there will be at least one such simplex. Any doubts? And Amal will take over from here, and he'll prove the Brouwer's theorem.
Yeah. Am I audible? Yeah. Okay. So, right now what we have is the Sperner's lemma, and Mayank just mentioned that it could be generalized to a multi-dimensional case. So I will try to explain what exactly does we mean by that. So what is the relation between a triangle and a simplex? So I will first define what a simplex is. So for an n-dimensional simplex, we denote it by delta n, and it is defined as So an n-dimensional simplex is something defined like this. So you have a set of n numbers and they should add up to 1. So you can think of it as a probability distribution, and that is why we can prove Nash's theorem using Sperner's lemma. So I will quickly give an outline of how I am intending to prove this. So suppose we are given a n-dimensional simplex like this. So first I will prove a lemma. Oh yes, so sure, yeah. Yeah. So I made a typo. So it is summation is less than or equal to 1. Yeah. So what I mean is that what Mayank showed here was a triangle, right? So this is a two-dimensional simplex, or in this notation, it is like delta 3. So you can think of it like convex combination of points 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, and 1, 0, 0. So if you take a convex combination of these points, then you can say that it is similar to a triangle. So to see that it is rather simple. So suppose you have a three-dimensional space, and these will be the unit vectors. So if you take the convex combination of all these points, you will get a triangular surface. So this triangle is what was the triangle in the construction for Sperner's lemma. So actually, to generalize Sperner's lemma, we need a labeling which satisfies the Sperner's condition. So in Sperner's condition, we had that the coloring scheme should satisfy some properties. And for a general n-dimensional case, we will have these rules of the labeling. So vertices of the large simplex are labeled with different labels. And for similar to the triangle case, we have another condition also for the same. So so I will start by proving a lemma. So suppose we have a function from an n-dimensional simplex to another n-dimensional simplex. So, and it is a continuous function. Then f has a fixed point. So, what this means is that there is an x such that f of x is equal to x. So this is what I'm setting out to prove here. So let us see how we can prove this. So I won't be going into a general case, because we have delta 3, and Sperner's lemma is proved for delta 3 by the previous argument. So we will prove this for delta 3, functions from delta 3 to delta 3. And for a general case, Sperner's lemma could be generalized to a simplex, as I told, and this will hold true. So, how do you proceed in proving something like this? You can go for a proof by contradiction. Suppose we have, suppose there is no fixed point for the function. So that is the assumption I will take. And then I will give a contradiction as to, from the construction from Sperner's lemma, I will get a contradiction. So that is my roadmap. So, so what is the idea behind Sperner's lemma? So we need a coloring scheme for the, we need a coloring scheme for delta 3 which satisfies Sperner's condition. And now I will try to define that coloring scheme. So for each element, we will define the color as follows. So I'm defining a coloring scheme like this. So fi of x, so we can see that delta n is an element in R3. Delta n is an element in Rn generally, but here we are looking at a three-dimensional simplex. So we have for we have a coloring which is minimum of I such that f of I of x is less than x. So I will try to say what this means. So first we have to see that this is a proper coloring. So what I mean by proper coloring is that this satisfies the conditions for Sperner's lemma. So I will try to see that we also need to be sure that this is a well-defined rule, that this gives a color to every point, right? We need this to give a color to every point. So first I will see that this is a well-defined rule. So suppose this is not a well-defined rule, then we will have that fi of x is less than x is not satisfied for I equal to 1, 2, and 3, right? So what this basically means is that fi of x is greater than or equal to x for all I, that is I equal to 1, 2, 3. Fi is just the ith component of f. So in general case, it will be ith component of the n vector. So here, what do you have here? So, this is a real valued function. So if you're confused by this notation, so this is just the n-dimensional simplex. So there will be points in Rn. And this takes a point in Rn and maps to another point in Rn. Right. Yeah, it is there. So I'm implicitly assuming. So I didn't bother to write it down. Yeah, so I want to show that this is a well-defined coloring. That is, each point gets a specific color, and for that if it's not well defined, then this condition will hold. That is, we need only three colors in the three-dimensional case, and for 1, 2, and 3 this is not satisfied for any number I. So that is what it means, and there you will have this coming up. So that will give you this. And you can see that f is a function which maps from a simplex to a simplex, right? So if you take an element of, so we have that fi of x just one second so this is a function from delta n to delta n, as I said. So you want to assign numbers to all the so you want to assign, so I will show that this coloring satisfies the Sperner's condition. So suppose we have so what are the Sperner's conditions for the triangle? So the Sperner's condition for triangle is like for the different edges, like this is 1 0 0, let's say this is 0 1 0 and this is 0 0 1. So these three things should be colored differently is what the coloring scheme for Sperner's lemma should give. So you can see that if you look at this coloring rule, then we have that for the 1 0 0 point, it will be like fi of x is less than x. So here only the first color could be given, because all other points would have a zero value for this. So you can only give color 1 to this point. Similarly, you can only give a color 2 to this point and only a color 3 to this point. So that condition of Sperner's lemma will be satisfied. So then we have the second condition for Sperner's lemma, which is that between these two points, if you take any point in these sets, that will be colored by either of these two colors. So that is the second condition for Sperner's lemma. And we can write any point in this as a linear combination of these two. So lambda times 1 0 0 plus 1 minus lambda times 0 1 0, and you will have lambda 1 minus lambda 0. So we can see that in this case also, as the x value will be always 0 for the third component, you can only give colors 1 or 2 for any point in this set. So we can see that this is a proper valid coloring for the Sperner's lemma case. And now we can apply the Sperner's lemma here. So what does Sperner's lemma give you? So this coloring scheme satisfies the conditions required for Sperner's lemma. And now from Sperner's lemma, we have that for any subdivision, we will have a sub-triangle which is labeled with all the edges. So that is the only thing I am going to use. I am not going to use a general result, as in the number of anti-clockwise is equal to 1 plus number of clockwise. I am not going to use that. I am just going to use the fact that there is one sub-triangle with all the colors used. So suppose we can subdivide the triangle into many divisions, as Mayank pointed out. Like, if we subdivide it once, we get four triangles. If we subdivide it once more, we'll get 16, and so on. So for a general nth subdivision, so suppose we have a general nth subdivision, and so what we have from Sperner's lemma is that for an nth subdivision, we will have a point such that all these three are given different colors. So that is what we have from Sperner's lemma. So without loss of generality, we can assume that the first point is given color 1, second point is given color 2, and the third point is given color 3. And now consider, so actually we have defined it for an M subdivision, and we can let this M be arbitrarily large. So suppose this M tends to infinity, and consider the sequence of points Vm1, for instance. So for these points, so I should maybe be a little more formal. So for m greater than or equal to 1, so this will give you further subdivisions and points on the subdivisions. So as we can see, this is a sequence, and it might have a limit or it might not have a limit. But in this case, we have that we are working with simplices here, so we are working with delta n, which is a compact set. So every sequence will have a convergent subsequence. So even if this sequence is not converging, we will have a subsequence. Say we can denote the subsequence by a subscript L, let's say. And this subsequence will converge to for some x in delta n. So this VLX will converge to some x in delta n, because delta n is a compact set, and VL1 are elements from the same set itself. There will be a subsequence which converges to a point in itself. So what we have is that this is for component 1, and similarly we will have for components 2 and 3. So in the end, what we will have is like f of v1l tends to f of x1. F of v2l tends to f of x2 n. And same for the third component. Now we can see that we have assumed without loss of generality that this is colored 1, this is colored 2, and this is colored 3. So if you recall our coloring scheme, so in our coloring scheme, we have defined our coloring scheme in this manner. So what we will have is that color of the first vertex is 1. So the first component will be, so color is 1 means that function value will be strictly less than the value, strictly less than the value of x. So we will have that. We will have that f1 of x is less than or equal to x. So we will have these three conditions. But this implies that their summation is also following the same thing, that is, and as we know, the function f is from simplex to simplex. We will have that this is possible if and we have that these sums are all equal to 1, because we have a, because we are working in a simplex, and so this is possible if and only if fi of x is equal to xi. So what we have arrived at is a contradiction to the initial assumption that this is f is not having a fixed point. So that will give us a contradiction, and so this lemma is proved. So what we have now is that for a function from n dimensional simplex to an n dimensional simplex, if it is continuous, then it has a fixed point. So now I will try to generalize this simplex into a convex set. So Brouwer's fixed point theorem says that for any non-empty compact and convex set, if it's continuous, if the function f is continuous, then f has a fixed point. So now we have proved this for n-dimensional simplexes, and we want to extend this to general compact and convex sets. So how do we do that? So I won't prove this rigorously. I mean, so there is this topological equivalence between a simplex and a so just as I said, the simplex in delta 3. The simplex delta 3 could be represented as a triangle. So similarly, delta 3? It is a triangle. So it is just that I am defining it in In my notation, what I'm meaning is that two-dimensional simplex means you will have 3 points. Like, yes. 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 So, what I mean is that delta 3, I am denoting, but I've been using this notation since before also. So, I am using that now. So, what I mean is that this delta 3 is topologically equivalent to R2. So, topologically equivalent to unit ball in R2. So, you can see that the triangle in two dimension is topologically equivalent to a closed unit ball in R2. So, similar to that, you can see that any n-dimensional simplex is topologically equivalent to an n minus 1 dimensional ball. So, from this we can get the original Brouwer's fixed point theorem, which says that for a compact and convex set we have a fixed point. So the idea here is that there will be a function taking the triangle to a closed unit ball, and as this function is continuous and it will have an inverse, these two are topologically equivalent. So if you compose that function and use it in the Lemma case, then you will have a fixed point theorem for the general case. So I'm not going into the details here. So now that we have Brouwer's fixed point theorem, how do we go on to prove Nash's theorem from this? So So we'll see how to prove Nash's theorem from using Brouwer's theorem. So we have a strategic form game. And now we define. Okay. So, so this is the statement of Nash's theorem. Every finite strategic form game has at least one mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So, how do you represent this mixed strategy Nash equilibrium? So, So how do you represent this mixed strategy Nash equilibrium? So, mixed strategy for a player I is a distribution on his strategy set. He will have a probability distribution for all the actions in his set, and for n players, what we'll have is a cross product of these sets. So what we'll have is a So this is the set of all probability distributions for you can represent an equilibrium by an element of this set, because this gives a mixed strategy profile for each of the players. And now what we have is that suppose we have something like this. Now what we want is a map, a continuous map. So we can see that this is a compact set, which is a requirement for Brouwer's fixed point theorem. So because we are assuming the strategy sets to be compact, and product of compact spaces is compact, so we'll have that. This is also a compact space, and now what we want is a function, and a function such that the fixed point for that function is the mixed Nash equilibrium. So I will define a function f which will take a given strategy profile into a better strategy profile. So I will define how that looks like. Yeah, so I will define a function f like this. So you can intuitively see what it means. So suppose you have a candidate for equilibrium, which is an element of this set. So sigma will be an element of this set. I want to define a function f from M to M, where M is like this, and I want to construct an f such that the fixed point of that function will give me the mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So what this means is that if you have a strategy Sik which is better than the current strategy, then that strategy will get more weight. So as this keeps happening, something which is a fixed point for this function will necessarily be a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So you can prove that using contradiction. Actually, like you can divide this into two cases where this term is positive and otherwise, and you can see that this function f from M to M we know that this has a stationary point because of Brouwer's theorem, and we can show that corresponding to this f, we will have a fixed point, and that will correspond to the mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So yeah, so basically that's it. You can go through any good game theory reference to see how this is done? So yeah, so I think we will move on to tutorial problems now. Okay.